body's a suspect.
Coming to get you, Bobber.
Halloween Night is a 2020 horror movie directed by J.P. DeStefano, and it stars J.P. DeStefano, Michael Tula, and Samantha DeStefano. Before I begin, J.P., I'm hoping I'm saying your last name right. Is it J.P. DeStefano or DeStefano? Michael Myers returns to Haddonfield after a long absence to continue his killing spree. At first I was going to give this an honest and critical review, but then I saw my name at the very end of this. I didn't realise that my name was going to be in the special thanks, so thanks to JP for that. So I'm going to just love it anyway. I'm only joking, I'll be honest. Or will I? The same with any fan film, guys. I'm going to review this as a fan film, so if I tell you that it's one of the best that I've seen, it's not one of the best movies in Hollywood that I've seen, it will be one of the best fan films. And the same goes for every category that I talk about. I'm going to be basing it as a fan film and not an actual movie itself. With all fan films, there are going to be some positives, there's going to be some negatives as well. There's not that many negatives, to be honest. I will be honest with you straight away, guys. So I'll start with the positives, and then at the end I'll talk about what I would have changed. First off, I'm going to talk about the camera quality and the cinematography throughout the film, as well as the lighting. I'll talk about it all at once. I think it was great. I think it was probably the best lighting that I've seen in any fan film, especially a Halloween slash Michael Myers fan film. I'm a photographer, as I keep mentioning to you all, and I'm sure JP can clear this up, but I know for a fact that somebody in this crew behind Halloween Night as a photographer, and if not, they should be a photographer, because most of this movie was a photographer's dream. The way they filmed it was perfect. The cinematography was great as well. The lighting was excellent. The lighting reminded me of a late 1980s cheesy horror movie, and that's a positive. The red, the green, the blue, the purple, all the times that they used this lighting throughout the movie, it reminded me of an 80s cheesy horror movie, and it was perfect. It was great. It didn't feel like a Halloween film at those points. It just felt like this 80s cheesy horror movie that I absolutely love. It was amazing. If I had to compare this lighting to one 80s cheesy horror movie that it reminded me of, it would be Night of the Demons from 1988. When I talk about the cinematography, that also ties into Michael Myers himself. You have to have good cinematography for a Michael Myers movie, never mind a fan film. And some of the shots in this rival, if not, are better than most of the actual Halloween movies we've had in the past. Michael does a lot of creeping in this film, he does a lot of stalking, he's standing in the background. Those types of shots are the shots that I love and I appreciate, and that's what JP puts into this one. I really like the music in this. The music mixed with the score itself, it was mostly score, not music, but he used the original score, obviously. He also used Rob Zombie's score as well, and he also used the new score from John Carpenter and Cody Carpenter from the 2018 Halloween. He mixed it all together. Sometimes that doesn't work. In this one, it does work because the certain scenes that they used specific scores from made it work. If we just randomly used all the score at once in all different scenes, it wouldn't work. But I think that they chose the score specifically for the scenes that they were used in, so I think the score was great in this one. Let's talk about the acting. Remember, guys, as a fan film, the acting is not Oscar worthy, but I think the acting was above average for a fan film, if not one of the best acting that I've seen in fan films. You do see that some fan films are put together within days and it's a group of friends just acting, and you can tell they're not taking it seriously. This film was taken seriously. The acting was really good in it as well, especially from JP. I didn't realise how much of a role JP would take in this film, but JP was one of the standouts. I'm still going to be talking about my positives, guys, but from here on out, with the rest of the positives and some of the negatives, there will be some spoilers. So if you haven't seen the movie itself, don't watch the rest of this review. If you don't mind spoilers, continue watching. And obviously, if you've seen the movie, then hopefully you can continue watching my review. There were some great nods to the original franchise, as well as John Carpenter himself. You've got people wearing Big Trouble in Little China t-shirts. You've got names that were used in the original movies, like Ronnie, for example. You've even got, near the end of the film, where they're selling their house and they're selling it through Strode Realty, obviously a tribute to the original franchise, as well as the seller of the house being Lindsay Wallace. Things like that are great for fan service. Sometimes they're too much when they're used in the wrong way, especially with some of the stuff that they use in the 2018 movie. But for a fan film, we can relax because it doesn't take itself too seriously. But when you think about it itself, All the nods in this fan film didn't take away from the film itself. They were used just as tributes, not to carry a story. There were some things that were used to carry a story, which I'll mention, but most of the fan service was great. And with the last of my positives, this could be seen as a negative, but I still see it as a positive. At times, even with Michael on screen, even with the score, it didn't feel like a Halloween film at times. And that's not a negative, because it felt like its own movie. It felt like they were making something their own, but bringing Michael on that journey with them. So I think that was really well done. Some people would see that as a negative because they might think, nah, it doesn't really feel like a Halloween film. It takes me away from Halloween, but it didn't take me away because I already knew it was a Halloween film with Michael being there and the score being there. That was enough for me to know that it was a Halloween film, but at times it did feel like its own movie. I take that as a positive, but I know that some people might see that as a negative. Some of the dialogue was cheesy, but that was to be expected. At times, some of the dialogue extended itself too much. They gave us too much information at times, and again, that doesn't take anything away from the film. But if I have to be honest and critical, then I would say that was a negative, because I didn't care for some of the dialogue. I just wanted to see more of the good things happening. Some scenes did play out very much like they did in some of the original movies. We've got not carbon copies of what happened before, but they took inspiration and made it a tribute, I would say, but they took inspiration from certain scenes in certain Halloween movies and put it into their own. They did have a lot of their own original ideas, and albeit they took some of their original ideas and changed it around, but I felt like there was maybe too many of those in this film. Now here's something I wouldn't say is a negative, but something that they could have explored a little bit more. I noticed at the beginning that Samantha made a phone call to one of her friends, and it came up Samantha Loomis, and I thought, oh, that's a nice tribute to Dr. Loomis. But then we find out that she's married to John, who's played by JP, and his name is John Loomis, and it seems like that's, well, it is his grandfather, so he is the grandson of Dr. Loomis. Now, they didn't explore that. We had some newspaper cuttings and articles of Dr. Loomis, just to confirm that yes, John is the grandson of Dr. Loomis. But is that why Michael is there? Is he there to kill him? Or did they just stumble upon John? It's not really confirmed, and we don't explore that aspect unless he's deciding, or he's got an idea of making more Halloween movies in the future, then they might explore that more. But if they don't, I think it was a missed opportunity, because they've made him a grandson for a reason, but they just didn't explore that. Somebody in the film had to leave work early because they heard the news that one of the prison transport buses crashed, and obviously that is Michael's bus that crashed, just the exact same way as it did in Halloween 2018. So they're using a part of that story to continue on in this story itself, which is a great idea. It's very original. They can take that aspect and move forward with it. But in this one, I felt like they could have played that out a little bit more. They could have made that, if they took away the Dr. Loomis aspect, took away the fact that John was the grandson of Dr. Loomis, if they used the bus crash as the main focal point of this story, that would have been a great twist. They could have just had Michael appear, kill people, and then disappear again on to kill Laurie Strode as part of that timeline, because there was gaps in the 2018 Halloween movie where Michael was going around door to door killing people. What if part of that story, let's say an hour of that story, where Jamie Lee Curtis and everybody else was, Laurie Strode, were away talking or whatever, let's say an hour and a half of that storyline was missing. That could have been Halloween night, that could have been JP's story. Again, that's just an idea, and they didn't run with that, but I think that with them talking about the bus crash, that would have been a great opportunity to make this Halloween night fan film a semi-spin-off of what happened in between, of what is missing from the 2018 Halloween movie. Again, that's not a negative. I had to put it in the negative because that's something I would have changed, but I still think, where am I going with this? I think that that can be seen as a negative because I would have done it differently, but it doesn't mean that what they did do was bad. I still would have changed that part of the storyline. Some dialogue and tightening up of the script aside, I think it was a perfect fan film, guys. I'm not just saying that, and I'm truly not just saying that because I've got a special thanks at the end of this. That's not the reason for it. I'm very honest when it comes to fan film reviews and movie reviews. I try and be as honest as I can. I can't find that many negatives apart from the script itself and the dialogue being tightened up slightly. Everything else was perfect. So have any of you guys seen Halloween Night yet? If not, there's no excuses because it is free on YouTube. I'll leave a link down below to the actual movie itself. And leave your comments down below, guys. Let me know what you think of it. Also, let me know what you think of fan films in general and where this ranks with the Halloween fan films. I'll tell you right now, guys, and again, it's not because I'm in the credits. It's truly not. I think this is the best Halloween fan film to date. As always, guys, thanks a lot for watching. Thanks for subscribing. I'll see you soon. Bye-bye.